Elsie de Wolfe, also known as Lady Mendl, December 20, 1859, July 12, 1950, was an American actress, interior decorator, nominal author of the influential 1913 book The House in Good Taste, and a prominent figure in New York, Paris, and London society. According to The New Yorker, interior design as a profession was invented by Elsie de Wolfe, although the praise is not strictly true. De Wolfe was certainly the most famous name in the field until the 1930s, but the profession of interior decorator, designer was recognized as a promising one as early as 1900, 5 years before she received her first official commission, the Colony Club in New York. During her married life, from 1926 until her death in 1950, the press often referred to her as Lady Mendl. She was born in New York and died at Versailles, France. In the 18th century, interior decoration was the purview of upholsterers, who sold fabrics and furniture, and architects, who employed a variety of craftsmen and artisans to complete interior design schemes for clients. By the late 19th century, the skills of designers such as Candace Wheeler and design firms like the Herter Brothers were well known. While Elsie de Wolfe was not the first interior decorator, she reaped maximum publicity through her social and commercial contacts, becoming the field's most famed practitioner of the early 20th century. Among de Wolfe's distinguished clients were Amy Vanderbilt, Anne Morgan, the Duke and Duchess of Windsor and Henry and Adelaide Clay Frick. She transformed the interiors of wealthy homes from dark wood, heavily curtained palaces into light, intimate spaces featuring fresh colors and reliance on 18th century French furniture and accessories. In her autobiography, De Wolfe, born Ella Anderson De Wolfe and the only daughter of a Canadian-born doctor, called herself a rebel in an ugly world. Her sensitivity to style and color was acute from childhood. Arriving home from school one day, she found her parents had redecorated the drawing room. She ran in and looked at the walls, which had been papered in a William Morris design of gray palm leaves and splotches of bright red and green on a background of dull tan. Something terrible that cut like a knife came up inside her. She threw herself on the floor, kicking with stiffened legs, as she beat her hands on the carpet. She cried out, over and over, "It's so ugly. It's so ugly." Hutton Wilkinson, president of the Elsie de Wolfe Foundation, clarifies that many things de Wolfe hated, such as Bickle and Plum Morris furniture, are prized today by museums and designers. De Wolfe simply didn't like Victorian, the high style of her sad childhood, Wilkinson said, and chose to banish it from her design vocabulary. Elsie de Wolfe's first career choice was that of actress. She originally appeared with the Amateur Comedy Club in New York City as Lady Clara Seymour in A Cup of Tea, April 1886, and as Maud Ashley in Sunshine, a one-act comedy by Fred W. Broughton, December 1886. Her success led to a full-time theatrical career, making her professional debut in Zardoz Thermidor in 1891, playing the role of Fabienne with Forbes Robertson. In 1894 she joined the Empire Stock Company under Charles Frohman. In 1901 she brought out The Way of the World under her own management at the Victoria Theatre, and later toured the United States in the role on stage. She was neither a total failure nor a great success. One critic called her the leading exponent of the peculiar art of wearing good clothes well. She became interested in interior decorating as a result of staging plays, and in 1903 she left the theater to launch a career as a decorator. Undoubtedly one of the first interior designers, Elsie de Wolfe is considered by some to have invented the occupation, although evidence reveals the profession existed before she made her considerable name. Through her efforts, American homes were introduced to a succession of sophisticated yet simple ideas, generally based on Elsie's preference for late 18th century French style. Many elements aided her in becoming such an influential figure in the emerging field: her social connections, her reputation as an actress, and her success in decorating the interior of the house she shared with her close friend, Elizabeth Marbury. Preferring a brighter scheme of decorating than was fashionable in Victorian times, she helped convert interiors of dark, heavy draperies and overly ornate furnishings into light, soft, more feminine rooms. She made a feature of mirrors, which both illuminated and expanded living spaces, brought back into fashion furniture painted white or pale colors, and indulged her taste for chinoiserie, chintz, green and white stripes, wicker, trompe-l'oeil effects in wallpaper, and trelliswork motifs, suggesting the allure of the garden. As de Wolfe claimed, "I opened the doors and windows of America, and let the air and sunshine in." Her inspiration came from 18th century French and English art, literature, theater and fashion. Elsie de Wolfe's taste was also practical, eliminating in her schemes the clutter that occupied Victorian homes, enabling people to entertain more guests comfortably. She also popularized the chaises longues, faux finish treatments, and animal print upholstery. In 1905, Stanford White, the architect for the Colony Club and a longtime friend, helped de Wolfe secure the commission for its interior design. The building, located at 120 Madison Avenue, near 30th Street, would become the premier women's social club on its opening 2 years later, much of its appealing to the interiors de Wolfe arranged. Instead of the heavy, masculine overtones then pervasive in fashionable interiors, Elsie used light fabric for window coverings, painted walls pale colors, tiled the floors, and added wicker chairs and settees. The effect centered on the illusion of an outdoor garden pavilion. The building is now occupied by the American Academy of Dramatic Arts. The success of the Colony Club proved a turning point in her own life and career, launching her fame as the most sought-after interior decorator of the day. Over the course of the next 6 years, Elsie designed interiors for many prestigious private homes, clubs and businesses on both the East and West Coasts. By 1913, her reputation had grown so that her studio took up an entire floor of offices on Fifth Avenue. That year she received her greatest commission, from coal magnate Henry Clay Frick, one of the richest men in America at the time. On his retirement, he moved from Pennsylvania to New York City, where his mansion was constructed by Thomas Hastings between 1912 and 1914. Sir Charles Ellam, known for his work remodeling Buckingham Palace, was engaged to decorate a number of rooms on the first floor of the home, while Elsie was hired to arrange the second floor, including the sleeping quarters. Earning a steep commission for every piece of art or furniture she purchased for Frick, Elsie became a very rich woman. Elsie de Wolfe continued to design interior spaces for notable clients, and wrote regularly for the press, including a column in Good Housekeeping and feature articles for Vogue. During World War I, she volunteered as an heiress in France, for which service she won the Croix de Guerre. It wasn't until nearly the end of her career that, at the age of 61, Elsie married